What's going on, successors? Welcome to another episode of the Speak Your Success podcast. This, of course, is a Speak Your Success media production. And y'all, I'm excited today because I'm in the Cosign Studios right now. Okay, we're in the Cosign Studios. We live on location for our amazing guests that we're hosting today. And today, y'all, we're here with KG Graham, who attended Northwood University and the University of Texas at Arlington, where he studied advertising and marketing. KG is a Dallas-based Pandamanian entrepreneur, curator, digital media marketing strategist, and story seller. In 2011, KG found Cosign Media Group, and later adding the award-winning Cosign magazine, where he focuses on connecting creatives with one another by co-signing them. KG has built Cosign as a dynamic, forward-thinking agency and media company that champions emerging talent in various industries. The organization focus is centered around helping establish young creatives and entrepreneurs. Welcome to the show, KG.
Man, thanks for having me. Thanks for the introduction too, man.
Yeah, I man, like most definitely. Man, we've been seeing you out here, man.
Yeah. I'm trying, bro.
Yeah,
I'm
man, been seeing you getting active, you know, just what? Because it's been 5 years since the last time we sat down.
Dang.
Yeah, bro.
It's been 5 years.
It's been 5 years, man.
Man, that's crazy. That's crazy. I appreciate you having me again, bro.
Yeah, man. I appreciate you taking the time. Because from seeing, you know, seeing the interviews you've been doing, I've been seeing you giving the game, talking about marketing campaigns.
For sure.
Talking about sponsorship deals.
Definitely.
Got the awards, right?
The awards.
Cosign Awards. You know, you've been building this. So you've been building Cosign to a household name.
That's right? The goal. That's the goal. It's crazy you said that. So I essentially, at the end of the day, I want Cosign to be a household name like Coca-Cola, Walmart, AT&T. You know, so you may not be a direct customer of it, but you know exactly what it is.
For sure.
So yeah, that's the goal, man.
Yeah, man. I mean, I think it's just been dope just seeing how strategic you have been. Because, you know, just like I said, we've been connected for, it was 5 years since the last time we sat down, but we've probably been connected like 8 years, maybe?
Yeah, it's been a minute. Probably like eight, maybe a decade at this point.
Yeah, probably, man. Yeah, probably a dime. Yeah, a whole dime. So, as we just look at the landscape of what you've been able to do with the brand and what you've been able to do with the company, like, can you just talk about, like, because we've been connected for that long, can you just talk about what have been some of the challenges of you building your media company?
Man, honestly, I would say one challenge is finding the actual niche for Cosign. That's why I always recommend business owners to figure out your niche first before you start, right? Because we pivoted so much. Luckily, we've been able to pivot, and it actually attracts, you know, our audience, customers, clients, and consumers. So we've been able to manage and sustain. But yeah, definitely finding a niche has been a challenge, because when you think of the term cosign, right, you can cosign anything. Cosign is essentially like a stamp of approval. Mm-hmm. It could be a word of mouth, etc. So you can cosign a restaurant, you can cosign a sporting team, you can cosign your barber, beautician, etc. So it's like, okay, how can you put the essence of Cosign into a company and a structure that makes sense for everyone to understand, right? And that want to support it. So, but we've been doing good so far, but you know, it's time to do great now.
For sure. Okay, so what you're saying great, that just makes my mind go to this term that's been thrown around on social media. I think scaling, right?
Right.
You know, growing, scaling a business. So, just with you wanting to make that transition, what would you say are some crucial elements to scaling a business?
Man, definitely a great team, right? Because for one, you can't do it alone. You can't do it by yourself. But before you, this is just my opinion, but before you get a team, I feel like you should exhaust all options, right? You should do marketing, operations, bookkeeping, everything. You should do it all until it becomes a point that you can no longer do it all. Like, until you're losing money because you're doing it all, and then you get a team. Some people try to get a team too early. They don't even understand what they want that team member to do or the next employee to do. So, like, and then you hire them, you may not even know if they're doing a good job, because you know what to base it off of, right?
That's true.
So I would say exhaust all options yourself as a solo founder, solopreneur, and then get a team. That'll help you scale. And also say learn technology and automation, right? Mm. I'm not an expert at it yet, but you know, we have been using different tools such as Notion, Slack. Those are the main tools we've been using. It's crazy, recently this week on Instagram, I posted a question asking what's the best CRM. So now we're looking for a CRM tool. Mm-hmm. Right now, a lot of people said HubSpot. HubSpot's a little pricey, but HubSpot's one, Salesforce, Go High Level, Monday.com. So we're looking to get a CRM, just, you know, streamline our processes and operations.
I guess you're okay. So you said get the team, but before you get the team, you said
exhaust
you
all
want
options.
To make sure,
yeah, exhaust yeah, all
you
options.
Make sure you understand first.
Get a team, automate technology.
Okay, okay. And then when we get to that, when we get to that place, right, to where we're talking about scaling the business and moving the business forward, there's another term that I hear often or an acronym, you know, they talk about KPIs.
Yes.
Like KPIs. And you know, this is another term for like metrics.
Right.
So for you with your business, what would you say are the metrics that you prioritize to measure the success of your company?
It varies, but like overall, we measure engagement for our website. So reading, how many viewers we have on there, how long are they staying, subscribers for our email newsletter, how's it growing, at what trajectory. Of course, we can measure social media growth, engagement there. But a new thing that we've been measuring is our subscriptions, right? So we launched a Cosign subscription, right? So it's $25 bi-monthly. So every other month, $25, you get automatically a magazine shipped directly to your door. Mm. And it comes with access to all our network and mix for as long as you subscribe, right? So you'll get access to that for free, a magazine, cocktails, and you'll be a part of the Cosign family. So we've been tracking that, right? So that we want to make sure we grow 20% quarterly. So, okay, so what are we doing to make sure that that grows? So that's kind of stuff that we kind of focus on when it comes to key KPIs, which I would say another thing too is try to get those early on, because like once you get a team and then you try to introduce KPIs later, right? It's a learning curve, right? Some people aren't used to it. So then as a founder, you kind of get frustrated because you're like, you guys aren't meeting these KPIs. And they're like, bro, we just started. So we're trying to figure out, you know, what's the best strategy for us. So another thing I recommend is training, man. Like corporations do it and it works. So as a, you know, as a small business owner, you really got to focus on training.
Man, that's so good. Because I don't know what I was watching the other day, but they were talking about somebody sitting down and recording the modules. It was an interview that you was in, actually. Mm-hmm. It was talking about you sitting down and recording stuff, but you was like, if you knew that there was companies that did it, you know, you would have outsourced that. But I guess it goes back to what you were saying earlier, exhausting all options first.
Exhausting all options, man. And it's crazy you said that. I'm actually doing that now because Paloma, who you met, she focused on La Vida Cosign, but now we're creating new other platforms for that. So I'm sitting having her screen record everything I do for Cosign so that she could duplicate it for La Vida Cosign, right?
Wow.
Because essentially having her do herself and then me going back to backtrack is more work that I shouldn't be touching. So it's like, okay, let me just screen record every process and then send that to them. And then it's their due diligence to actually watch the videos and produce, you know, the job.
Man, I like that. So if you haven't shared it already, because I want to skip over this, but is there, or what has been the most important lesson that you learned about the operations side of running a media company?
Man, creating SOPs. Taking the time to sit down and actually create the SOPs. I mean, it is a daunting task, right? Because when I first hired an assistant, she was like, okay, what do you do? And I started to tell her, and I'm like, man, I know I do more than that. And then she's like, okay, well, it takes the time. And then, you know, as you do stuff, write everything you do. And I'm like, dang. Mm. When I did that, I'm like, bro, I actually do a lot, right? And that's just like outlining. So imagine you got like you do 20 things within your business, right?
For sure.
Then you have to go back and detail each one of those 20 things. And you don't know how many details go into one thing, right? So for an example, we're doing a podcast right now, right? So essentially there needs to be an SOP for podcast production, okay? But you have to get so, so detailed. So for example, I did an SOP, right? I told my people, set up a stand for each person. You attach the microphone, attach the cable, and then you run it to the Rodecaster Pro, right? Uh-huh. And when they did that and I saw the video, they had the cord just hanging. And I'm like, in my mind, I'm like, why didn't y'all wrap the cord, right? But you have to have an SOP or they're just gonna do what they feel is right or what it's reading. So like now, like, okay, now I gotta get super detailed. Wrap the cord around the podcast pole 10 times to where that way it's maybe like an inch between each cord, go all the way to the bottom, make sure it's tight, make sure it's not loose, stretch it That's how detailed you have to get in SOPs, man. Wow. For every aspect of your business, bro. So it's gonna take, like, may take 2 days, 3 days, 4 days, but I highly recommend it, because then the time that you're gonna take away from your business having to sit down and train somebody, when you could be doing something that's actually generating revenue for you.
Mm, okay, so you're saying, get it right the first time.
Get it right the first time.
Because if you got to double back, then it's gonna cost more money, because it's costing more time.
Exactly.
Wow.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
Man. So like even now in my business, man, like I solely focus on revenue generating tasks.
Mm.
You know what I'm saying? Unless it's something that I want to personally do for one of my team members in the business, I'm focusing on revenue. If it doesn't generate revenue, I'm not doing it. Somebody, I delegate that off to somebody else.
Okay, so focusing on the revenue generating tasks, like how do you ensure that your business operations ultimately align with the creative vision overall?
So like kind of like we said earlier, like everything is a funnel, right? So I think of everything that can lead into turning somebody into a client, a paid subscriber, a viewer, because you know you get paid off of views on YouTube. So anything that can lead to that, right? So let's say our mixers, right? Some of our mixers are free, some are paid. Our free mixers is to give somebody a taste of the Cosign experience, the network and the community, to build them in. At the mixer, we may sell a magazine, or we may sell a subscription, or we may ask you to subscribe. You know, we're gonna offer something there because you came while we have you in person, right? Let's think about something else. The podcast. Listen to the podcast. We hope to provide enough value for you to subscribe to the YouTube, so that way mm-hmm. you continue to watch our podcast and those views will go up, which actually turns into advertising dollars on the back end of YouTube. What else we do? Okay, so media campaigns. So creating a social media strategy, having call to actions that leads people into becoming, you know, whether booking a discovery call, which will then turn to having them book a campaign, or are we doing their podcast production, social media, or photography and videography services.
Man, I like how streamlined you got that.
Man, had to, bro, because you got to think, man, for such a long time with Cosign, bro, I was just so focused on creating content. I'm like, man, you got to have content, got to get the viewers. Okay, I'm broke with content.
Yeah.
What are we doing? You know what I'm saying? Like,
yeah.
I got to keep the lights on. I got to buy equipment to record the content. So, yeah, it's a process, man.
All right, so as you're talking about content, and I know your CEO, I know you wear multiple hats. Right, and in that now, you know, because over the years, I've seen you begin to put other people in position. Because I've seen you sometimes with the camera.
Man, I do it all.
You know, I've seen you sometimes. I've seen you all the places. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. That's what I'm saying. I've seen you all the places, do all the things. But can you describe just in the aspect of, you know, on one side, it's the creative. And, you know, you see creative, you think of free thinker, flowing. That person not focusing typically on bottom line.
Right.
But then you got the CEO hat. So can you describe just a little bit how, not just for you personally, but how you've built your team to be able to handle the creative and the operational demands on both sides?
Well, so now we have like a team of 6 or 7. So like, for example, Paloma's a creative. I just let her create. You know what I'm saying? Like, you create, that's what you do, right? What I'll do is I'll tell you what our goals are and how your creation can lead to revenue. But you focus on creating, right? Mm. You focus on creating, bringing the people in, I'll close them. You know what I'm saying? Mm. That lets you do you and I can do me, and we're not stepping on each other's toes, all right? Emily, she's our CMO. She's great at strategy, right? But she doesn't do execution. So, okay, you come up with the strategy, we have a media team to execute, right? So like, they focus on media production, you focus on strategy, it goes hand in hand, and then you execute there, right? Our media team, they may be out shooting, all right, and then somebody like wants to book us as a client, they have to send them to me, and I handle all that, the admin, closing the deals, etc. They focus on recording and editing, shooting and editing, strategy, creating, I'll close the deals.
There it is. All right, family, I know you're enjoying this conversation. I hope you're enjoying it as much as I am. And we're gonna be right back to talk with KG a little bit more, talking about the operations as well as the future of Cosign. Looking for a fresh cut and a style that turns heads? Welcome to Reek Ellum Styling Suite, where barbering is an art. At Reek Ellum, we don't just cut hair, we create confidence. Specializing in precision cuts and the latest trends, we're all about helping you look and feel your best. From sharp fades to bold styles, every cut is crafted with care and detail. Reek Ellum Styling Suite is your go-to spot for top-tier barbering in an atmosphere that's laid back and all about you. Ready to elevate your style? Book your appointment at Reek Ellum Styling Suite today and leave feeling like the best version of yourself. All right, we're back, family. We're about to go ahead and dive right back in. Man, KG.
Okay.
So we was just chopping it up off camera a little bit, and I want to just bring to your attention. I want to just ask you this: has there ever been a time to where in your business you made a major investment, or is a strategic decision that didn't go as planned? How was it handled, and what lessons? What lessons did you learn?
I'm not gonna lie. I have a perfect example, right? Scenario story. But does it have to be business, or can it just be like an investment?
Investment. Talk to me.
I've been waiting to get this one on. So 2022, there was this investment group. Mind you, this is why I have a thing about fake gurus. I'm not gonna say any names, but this is why I have a thing about fake gurus, right?
Okay.
There was this investment group in Dallas to where, you know, 2021, everybody had access to capital because of the pandemic, PPP loan, et cetera. So this is an investment group to where they basically preyed on small business owners, entrepreneurs, people who had a little extra cash that wanted to invest and, you know, generational wealth.
For sure.
Right. So there was an opportunity to where you invest $8,000 to $9,000 into container homes, right? So their thing was like investing in these new container homes. You can be considered a real estate investor. These container homes, you're paying for the labor and the materials, and then you get 50% return on your investment, right? So let's say you pay $8,000, in 60 days you're guaranteed $4,000, right? So you pay $8,000 to get $12,000 every 60 days, right? A couple of my friends were doing it. They were actually making money. They showed me the wires, showed me. I'm like, cool. I trusted them, right?
Sure.
Which
sure.
They got scammed too, right?
Dang.
So I did it. And it worked, I'm not gonna lie, it worked.
Okay.
I did it a couple of times, put in eight, I got my 8 plus 4, I put in 16, got a 16 plus 8. So I'm like, cool. A couple of my friends are like, hey, how can I get on? I'm like, hey, it worked, I'm gonna put you on, right? Basically it was a Ponzi scheme, man. Like basically there were no containers. I ended up losing $100,000.
Oh, KG.
Yeah. So I lost $100,000. I mean, it was basically everything I had saved. Granted, I got some money back for like the first couple of months. So maybe like I lost like 80 or 75. But still, I lost a lot of money.
That's
and
good
I'm
money.
Due like $116,000, what they actually owe me, right? Now, from that investment, there's a couple of things I learned. One, regardless of what people say, contracts don't matter.
Oh, wow.
Regardless of what people say, contracts don't matter. You can have a contract, but if they don't have the money to pay you or everybody, you're not getting your money back. So the contract is void. It's like, it's pointless.
Ooh.
So that's one thing I learned. Second thing I learned, if it sounds too good to be true, it is. Right? If somebody's saying, oh, you're going to get 50, we're guaranteeing you 50%. All you got to do is sign this contract. It's too good to be true. How are you going to guarantee me half my money back, right? So, I mean, well, my whole money back plus 50% profit. Second thing. Third thing, for me, I will never invest in something I can't physically touch outside of stocks. Right? Stocks is something different. But if I can't physically go in to touch it, so for example, if I want to get into real estate, if I can't go walk that land, if I can't go touch that property, I'm not investing in it. Because essentially what I did was, bro, I took $100,000 and just lit it on fire. So yeah, those that was the hardest lesson ever learned in my life, because it's like, sometimes I wake up and my stomach hurts.
Man.
Cause like, dang, this is gone, right? Oh. But it's my fault because I didn't do my complete due diligence, right? I thought, one, because I had a contract, and two, because my friends did it and I saw wire transfers that it was, you know, legitimate. I also talked to the guy on the phone, had his number, but when things went downhill, he was nowhere to be found. Kind of find out there was multiple people he scammed in the past. Kind of find out there's multiple groups. All right, so we're putting this group of 60 entrepreneurs is putting their money to him. There's another group of 20 here, a group of 30 there. So he's taking their money, paying us, taking our money, paying them. And it got to a point where everybody wanted money back. He didn't have the money.
Ooh.
Yeah, man. And then another thing too is there was this girl who was basically leading the group, right? So I'm not gonna lie, I'm also mad at her too, because like, you brought her to us, right? How come you didn't do your fact checks before you put your people on? And then you created a community and started charging us $100 a month for these opportunities. So now you're getting $100 a month from 60 people for these opportunities that we just got scanned off of. And the fact that she's still here walking around irks my nerves, bro. Not saying nothing should happen to her, but I'm saying the fact that people still allow her to do business irks my nerves, man.
KG, that's one thing I never understood about people who have done scams, and then it's publicized that these individuals have done scams and these people still are living and walking among us.
I don't get it, bro. So that's I'm not gonna lie, that's something that really like affected me personally and business-wise, because like, you know, sometimes like I'll reinvest my capital back into Cosign. So to lose that amount of capital, you know, that some people worked their whole lives to get, man, it was heartbreaking, man. You know,
man.
But they do say real hustlers can get it, lose it, and get it back. So
that's what they say.
That's what they say.
We in your studio right now.
I mean, I ain't got 100,000 saved, but I'm doing okay.
Hey, you know, we don't need you to say what you got in the bank.
I'm doing all right.
But we in your studio.
We here.
That's all we saying.
That's all that matters. I got assets. That's all that matters. I got assets, okay?
Fair enough. So, all right, so just us being in the studio, right? A studio typically is synonymous with creating content, putting out content, quick turnaround, high quality content. So how do you balance the demand for immediate content with the need for high quality?
So with this studio, it gives me some flexibility, because one, I could just do a studio rental where you come produce your own content, right? Mm-hmm. That's a lesser charge. You just come use the space, you create your own content. That's up to you. Or there's an opportunity to where, you know, you could come here, co-sign and create it. Typically, we say about a 48 to 72 hour turnaround, depending on the project, because that's what we're kind of doing. As of late, we'll say 72 hours because the demand has been high. There's a lot of projects that we're working on, and we want to make sure we continue to provide the best quality. Also, we talked about scaling earlier. So like, as the demand rises, that means, okay, it's time to add on another editor or another producer, right? So you just gotta learn your business and where it's at, okay? Also, study the timing of your business, right? So summer is hot, people are outside. So August, September might be good, but then October is gonna start to decline because it's getting into holiday season. People are traveling, people are being with family, it's cold, people are inside. People are saving to get ready for next year. So just because it's hot right now, you don't wanna make any drastic decisions for the next quarter. So you kind of want to base it on like on an average of what you've done annually.
I like that's a good breakdown, KG. You've been doing your market research.
Man, look, bro, I spent a lot of money. You know, lost a lot of money. So it's like, man, I got to just get smarter. Just got to get smarter, bro. Tighten up, man. We've been in this too long not to tighten up.
Yeah, you're right. You got to tighten up, man.
Got to tighten up.
So just in keeping that same train of thought, right? Like you're talking about that turnaround time, and you talk about adding on a potential editor, that just makes me think of AI. So what role do you think that AI and machine learning will play in the future of media production, distribution? Talk to me.
Yeah, I mean, I think AI is perfect if you want something like fast and easy, right? But if you want something, you know, meticulously detailed and unique, you're still gonna need somebody to do that, right? So for example, I use Captions as an app, right, to do my captions, right? AI doesn't understand slang and everything, so sometimes I still have to manually go in there and correct some spelling, right? And then Caption also has an AI tool to where like they'll edit a video for you with like what you're saying, they'll mimic it within your background, right? Sometimes it's still horrible, so sometimes you still have to tweak it, right?
For sure.
It's like you can't, certain programs, you can't articulate exactly what you want. ChatGPT, you can tell ChatGPT exactly what you want for it to spit it out. Some AI platforms aren't there yet, so it's like you still need somebody to, you know, go in there. And in the media, there's a lot of platforms, right? You can take your long form content and put it in there and then spit out short form content. They're not always perfect, bro. Sometimes they're not picking the right clips, or sometimes like if we're doing a wide frame like this, they don't cut it, you know, the way we want to cut. Like instead of going back and forth, they may cut it on me and then may cut it on you, or we're trying to speak together and half of us aren't in the frame. So it's like, you need people for that as well. So I use AI for like quick, easy stuff. That way I have time for my team to go in and then do them like the meticulous edits and, you know, the customizations, et cetera.
That makes sense. Y'all heard that, folks. If you're in Dallas, you need to come to Cosign Studios. Like, stop doing the whole AI thing.
Man, I know y'all seen, what is it called? What's the Issa Rae movie? Issa Rae show?
I can't think of the Issa Rae show right now either.
Insecure.
Thank you, producer Britt.
Would she work at, would she say, we got y'all? We got y'all.
Man. All right, so, okay, we talked about AI, the production. So what do you feel is next for your media company? All right, any upcoming projects that people need to know about or expansions that you're really particularly excited about?
I mean, honestly, I'm excited to build a community within our studios, right? So offline, we talked about, you know, different memberships that, you know, you've been a part of that, you know, have been great, and they've been like national memberships, right? I want to get to a point to where Cosign has a national membership, but I really want to dive in into this program or this membership we're launching called Cosign 50. Mm. So basically what this Cosign 50 is, it's a membership where 50 entrepreneurs, not 51, 50, right? So we get to 50, then it becomes a waiting list, like no more than 50 people at a time, where we can actually have these 50 entrepreneurs utilize the space, utilize our resources, build with them mastermind workshops on a monthly basis, right? So we can actually watch them from iteration to like grow, help them grow and scale. So that's something we're interested in because, you know, with our space, we're able to not only, you know, have these events, but we're also able to like create content within here and help them on all aspects of the business. So that's why I say 50, because 50 is a sweet number to where it's still manageable for entrepreneurs to help everybody within our team. Mm-hmm. And then it also like it spikes demand, right? So if we get to 50 and then you're hearing all these amazing things, you want to be in there.
That's true.
But in order for you to get in there, somebody has to drop out. Mm. You know what I'm saying? So because I want it to be something to where we meet in person, right? I want to be able to look at you, see your struggles, your pain points, and talk and walk you through this. Once we're able to manage that 50, then we can create a program similar to that that's like on a national level to where, you know, it could be done virtually, et cetera.
For sure. I like that, man. Mm-hmm. I like that. And I mean, I've seen you always have been on just the pulse or aware of the pulse of the city with, you know, with the event you did about with the financial event. Help me out, KG.
Relationships with money.
Relationships with money, which I went through the program. Yeah, relationships with money, the Cosign Awards. And I've always seen you just always aware and of the pulse, like in these different markets, but it's been organic, right? It hadn't been like a force or a reach. Are there any new markets that you're particularly looking at, you know, leaning into a little bit more and expanding to?
It's not new, but we've had launched La Vida Cosign, which is essentially our media platform for Latino entrepreneurs, creators, executives, and professionals, right? So of course, Cosign in itself is diverse, but me being Afro-Latino Panamanian, I also want to make sure that, you know, our Latino audience feels, you know, seen and heard as well. So Paloma's over that platform. And with that, basically it mimics everything Cosign does. So we have events for La Vida Cosign, content, interviews, podcast series, and then we're going to launch a new newsletter for La Vida Cosign, to where it's that way, you know, Latino entrepreneurs can get connected with their, meet other Latino entrepreneurs, creators, influencers, and start to build an ecosystem around that. So like that's, it's not like necessarily an industry, but it's like our next, I would say, thing that we're focused on and want to grow that community.
That's what's up, man. That's what's up. And I'm rewinding the clock back just a little bit, but I remember when we first met, I would see you pushing heavy on the music side, right? Pushing heavy on the music side. I know you got a little bit of A&R in the background. Yeah. And I would see you interviewing, you know, a lot of musical artists, singers, different things like that. Are you interested? Are you interested in owning your own record label, KG?
No.
Really?
Nah, man. I'm out the music game, bro.
Why?
Game.
Talk about it. Why? Why we out of music?
The music business is one of the worst investments you can make, man. Mm. One of the worst investments you can make. I just want to consume music as a music lover. I don't want to tarnish my love for music by getting back into the music business, man. a good friend of mine, Jason Lyric, I managed him for like a year. Mm-hmm. And I love working with him. I love helping him.
For sure.
But I'm focused on building a coastal empire, man. So it's like, I didn't want, like, our relationship, it never like got tarnished or anything, but it's like, you could tell like I'm focused on Cosign, and he's like, man, I'm focused on my career. So it's like,
I get it.
My heart is into like what I'm building. And then, you know, no knock on artists. I love y'all, man, but artists are sensitive, man. If you remember the first Cosign Awards, we had music categories. And after that year, I was like, nah, no. They're too sensitive, man. I had a DJ call me the day of the awards. I'm like, hey, bro, did I win? I'm like, bro, you got to come to the awards final. Like, oh, man, I ain't coming if I ain't win. I'm like, hey, bro, don't even worry about coming. Take your suit off. You know?
Take your suit off.
Right. And then, you know, other artists that feel entitled to, like, man, I should be nominated or I should be in there. You know, so it's like music is an art. So it's hard to, like, gauge art, right? Who puts a value on art? You know, one person may not like reggaeton or hip hop, but there's people that love it, you know, that it's changed their lives. So, I try to not touch, you know. If anything, I focus for Cosign, I focus on the music business, like executives, A&Rs, owners, but I don't want to label, man. I just want to, you know, support artists from afar by streaming their music. If I have an event that, you know, needs some talent, you know, I'll book you, but as far as I'm going, man.
For sure. Just staying back on the CEO side.
Staying back on the
CEO side.
And you don't want somebody that got their hands in everything, right? Like,
that's true.
You know, like people say Jay-Z does all this. Jay-Z does not do all that. You know what I'm saying? Jay-Z has somebody over this, over that, over that. But it took him to be amazing at making music for him to do that. So, you know, as of now, let me be the GOAT at media, and then you never know, man. I might go into like building studios all around the nation, or I might buy a farm or something. I don't know, but I just need to be the best at this before I get outside of media. You know what I'm saying?
There we go. Y'all, we sitting here with the GOAT of media, Mr. Cosign, and Mr. Cosign himself, KG. Don't push that button just yet. When we return, we're gonna run him through the CEO hot seat. Hey. See you in a minute. Attention, all my entrepreneurs, all my business owners in the DFW area, Triple D. All right, look, this is just for you. I wanna help you as we're getting ready to roll out something new. This is gonna be our local business spotlight. All right, because I know you might be out there struggling, just trying to get more eyes on your branding, trying to get more eyes on your business, and trying to get more people to spend their coin with you. You know what I'm saying, because you know the struggle. So I just need this from you. I need you to, first of all, you need to tap in on Instagram at Speak Your Success Media. You want to follow the page to make sure that you see some of these other businesses that are getting rolled out and that are getting spotlighted, because you might be able to benefit from them as well. The second thing I need from you, I need you to fill out the form just down below. And on that form, what we have for you is you just give us a little bit of information about your business so we know how to spotlight you, how to promote you, how to talk about the high points about what you do best in your business. And lastly, you need to follow the podcast. Just type in Speak Your Success Media on Apple, on Spotify, or even on YouTube. Right? This way, you can begin to hear the entrepreneurial insights that I'm sharing every single week. It's free game, all right? Every single week. So tap in on the podcast and make sure that you fill out that form just down below. And I look forward to mentioning your business in the local spotlight. All right, family, so we're back, and this is the first time we're rolling this out. Okay, this is our CEO hot seat, because producer Britt said we need to have some fun on the show so we can show that entrepreneurs can have fun, all right? So this is what we're gonna do. KG, this is how the game works, okay? We're gonna put 1 minute on the clock. Producer Britt is gonna hit us with 1 minute on the clock.
Okay.
And we're gonna ask you a series of questions about becoming a media mogul. Well, since you said the GOAT, a media.
I like media mogul.
Okay. So we're gonna ask you a series of questions about becoming a media mogul.
Okay.
Producer Britt, give us a minute on the clock. KG, are you ready?
As ready as I'll ever be.
This is our CEO hot seat.
Okay.
And just roll off whatever comes to
mind. First thing that comes to mind, okay.
Yeah, you don't wanna just go back and forth, just roll.
Okay.
All right, and here we go. What are the first steps to building a sponsorship campaign?
First thing is outlining what event or what project that you're going to build out, and then highlight all the details, and then provide the value for it. So if somebody wants to sponsor your event, what value are they getting from sponsoring your event? Then put that into a deck.
Boom. If someone is looking to do a print magazine, where should they start?
They should start to see if they have the actual budget. Print is expensive, so I will start with print manufacturers, print shops, to see if it's still even worth to do print, and then figure out how much you're going to charge for the magazine, and if you have the audience that's going to buy it, because print is expensive, so that means your magazine is going to be expensive. Mm.
Top three things someone needs to host an event.
A DJ, a venue, and a theme.
Do I start small with a lot of advertisers, or do I go big or go home with one big advertiser?
At first, I will start off small with a few advertisers to test what you like and don't like. Then once you figure that out, I will focus in on one.
You got a big bowl of grits. You going to put salt in it, or you going to put sugar in it?
I'm not eating grits.
That's our CEO hot seat, folks. That's our CEO hot seat. Oh, my goodness. And just before we get into the wrap-up, KG, I want you to tell the people where they can find you, follow you, and connect with you.
Man, I have so many pages, so I'll make it easy for you guys. If you go on my personal page, Cosign KG on Instagram, and look at my bio, you'll see all my companies and businesses in my bio. Just tag, click those, and you can follow those. And then if you click on the link, you could definitely subscribe to Cosign. Please become a subscriber. There's a lot of value in that. And then, you know, just continue to support us at Cosign Studios, which is at cosign.studios, studios with the S like this.
There we go. So as we get ready to wrap it up, you gave and provided a lot of value today. To the aspiring entrepreneur that wants to get into the media space, right? Mm-hmm. What advice would you give that individual who's like, I want to start my own media venture? Like, what insight would you give to them?
I would tell them to start with one thing. If you looked at the pandemic and you looked how Earn Your Leisure grew, Earn Your Leisure had one podcast and they did it very well. They had quality guests, they provided quality content, and they shared it with the audience. And then it grew to become something massive. They didn't just start off with a podcast, the Business Academy, InvestFest. They started off with one thing and killed that. And then they grew from there. So I would tell anybody, find that one thing that's for you that you're gonna do every day without making any money for it, all right? And do that every day. And then as you continue to grow and build that audience, add the next layer to it.
There we go. And then KG, who's the next guest you'd like to see me interview on Speak Your Success?
Man, I'd like for you to interview David Shands.
Mm.
Yeah. No, I'll take that back. I want you to interview Neil DeVisa.
Okay. Yeah. Okay.
I would like to see that. Neo. Okay. Yeah.
Tag Neo, y'all.
Tag Neo. Make that
Tag
happen.
Neo. Okay.
Don't pull up.
Oh, man. Well, KG, man, thanks for hosting us, man, allowing us to swing through and allowing us to get some of your time today for you to add value to the people and do what you've been doing at a high level for, I mean, years. Just like I said before, because I remember all the way back to, what was it? Seeing you at that Riff Raff concert.
Ooh.
Yeah, that's back in the day. Profit Bar.
Ooh.
Yeah, back in the day.
Man, I've been outside for a little bit.
Man, been outside. But you've been outside and been adding value to the people, been making Cosign a household name. So, brother, man, thank you.
Man, I appreciate you, man. Yeah. Make sure y'all tune in.
Yeah, for sure. And family out there, if you have not subscribed to the channel, be sure to subscribe, Speak Your Success Media. And this has been Speak Your Success. And I just want to remind all my entrepreneurs out there, speak your success, believe in your greatness, and continue to create the life and business of your dreams. Why would you and why should you live any other way?